to All Things Antares. My name is Mark Silverstein. We will be discussing in this episode real-world performance for Antares catamarans and understand the difference between published performance metrics and safely cruising around the world. A little bit about my background. I've been an owner of an Antares catamaran for 9 years. My wife and I and two kids have been sailing the world and have so far sailed over 40,000 nautical miles in all sorts of weather conditions. And I'm really looking forward to this episode because there has been just a lot of internet chatter and conversations about what it really means to have a performance catamaran, but that's also safe and has the ability to be able to sail you and your family comfortably around the world. In this episode, we will be discussing design ratios, displacement numbers, polars, and tackling the big question, what is fast enough for a cruising catamaran?
Okay, so before I begin, I want to do a quick disclaimer. Performance is a very touchy subject for some people. They get very animated, very passionate about, you know, why they bought their boat and why their boat is the fastest boat on the water. And I just want to say this. Number one, the majority of catamarans sail good enough for most cruisers. That includes Lagoon, Fontaine Peugeot, Leopard, and most other manufacturers. Number two, performance is important, but it's not the primary reason why most buyers purchase a new cruising catamaran. Safety and comfort will usually outrank performance for a new boat buyer. And number three, the longer the boat, the faster the boat. It's called the speed-length ratio and looks something like this. But it's important to think about it this way. If you're sailing on a 45-foot catamaran and you are comparing performance numbers to a 50 or a 55-foot catamaran, those catamarans will always be faster with all the same considerations as far as the same displacement, same ratios, etc. Number four, fast is fun, but it's not always comfortable, and sometimes it's not as safe. Number five, not all displacement numbers are created equal. Some manufacturers will list dry displacement weight, some will list dry and loaded displacement weight, and some manufacturers don't specify whether the displacement is dry or loaded on their website. But one thing that you must never forget, nobody will ever sail their boat at dry weight, I can promise you that. Because of this, dry displacement means that nothing is on the boat. There are no liquids, meaning no fuel, no water. There's no personal effects. You've got no dinghy hanging off the back with your 30 horsepower engine. You've got no ground tackle with your 100 meters of chain, your 33 kilo anchor. Dry displacement is just that. Bone dry, nothing on the boat as it splashes it in the water for the very first time from the factory. Now, loaded displacement is everything on the board and then some. A lot of boats are designed to have a very high loaded displacement number, and that's okay. Most cruisers will never tap their boat out to the very top end of that loaded displacement.
Now that we have the disclaimers out of the way, let's talk about two of the primary sailing design ratios that most people discuss when it relates to boat performance. First of all, we have sail area as a ratio of displacement. And second of all, we have the length of the vessel as a ratio of displacement. These two ratios will give you a theoretical ranking, if you will, of boat performance. But it also leaves out some very important considerations. One of them, and the most important one, is hull design and hull shape. Any vessel that has narrower hulls, like let's take for example a Katana, will perform better than another boat of the same size and same weight and same sail area that has a lot larger, flatter, more of a larger displacement hull design. So you can't just look at the sail area displacement ratio or the length to displacement ratio and say, ah, this boat's going to perform great. It also depends on hull design. So for us to, I think, get a realistic comparison of boat performance, we need to really not zero in on what most manufacturers advertise, which is light displacement. We need to look at what I tend to call the cruising displacement numbers, not the loaded displacement numbers, because not every cruiser is going to go out and fully load out their boat to the capacity that's been designed by that boat manufacturer. So what we have done is this. We are taking light displacement that's advertised by the major manufacturers, and we're going to add some weight to that. We're going to add 60 meters of chain, 10 millimeter chain. We're going to add 33 kilos for an anchor. We're going to add a typical dinghy with a 15 horsepower engine. We're going to put that boat loaded up with around 75% fuel capacity, and we're going to have another 2,000 pounds for miscellaneous personal effects and provisions. So all of these numbers smashed together will be applied to the different manufacturers as we look at the rankings, and used for the what I'm calling the cruising displacement numbers to give us the ratios to be able to compare. So the big question is, where end of the day does Antares stack up? So if we take the cruising displacement number that we've discussed, and we apply the light displacement of the different boats and add to it the items that we previously discussed, here's what this looks like in graph form. So at the very top is the U-trimmer, and as we go down to the very bottom, the heaviest boat is the Exquisite X5 at around 45,000 pounds of displacement. And so if you look at these numbers alone, at around 24,000 pounds for the Antares 44, it's not the lightest boat on the list, but it's still fairly light. And that helps us in light winds perform fairly well. So if we move on and look now at the sail area as it relates to the cruising displacement. And sail area, let me just make a footnote here. The sail area is taking into consideration the mainsail and the genoa. This is not the mainsail and jib, this is the mainsail and genoa. And these areas were provided by the different manufacturers. So if you look at this, going from left all the way to right, the larger the number, in theory, the faster the boat based on the ratio of sail area over cruising displacement. So a couple things to point out. The Antares is kind of, you know, on the middle right-hand side, but the point here is all of these boats in the 19 to 20 to 21 range, even 22 with the U-trimmer, are all very similar. And so I think when you start to look at the actual ratio of sail area to displacement, some of these boats that are heavier have a lot more sail area, as they should. Some of the boats that are lighter, like the Antares, don't need all of the sail area that some of the heavier boats need. But the point is, as I mentioned at the very beginning, most all of the cruising catamarans are fairly similar in their SAD ratio, with a few exceptions. And as you start to get to the Katana in particular, they're doing, you know, they've got a 26, which is very fast. They don't carry a lot of fluids, and that's why. So when we did 75% of liquids, the Katana doesn't carry a lot of liquids. So then that 75% of a small number is a really small number. And so they get a lot higher displacement, a lot higher number just based on that alone. And that's one of the reasons for the big variance on the Katana. But they're also a fast boat. They're a well-made boat. Now, if you look at this and you think about light wind performance, I want to point out the Antares in particular, because the standard code zero is a sail that comes when you purchase a new boat. And when you factor in the mainsail and our code zero, our sail area displacement bumps all the way up to 26. And this is important because out of the gate, when you buy a new boat, you have a very good, robust sail plan, and the majority of cruising on a catamaran is going to be beam reaching to broad reaching the entire way. And the majority of the time that we sail field trip, we sail field trip with our code zero, I would say probably 60-70% of the time easily we are sailing with this configuration, which puts our ratio up at 26. And this is the dominant way that we sail our boat, is with our Code Zero. We had it specially made, especially reinforced. It's a little bit heavier than a standard Code Zero because we use it all the time, and it really pushes up our performance, as you can see on this chart. So in summary, you can see that the majority of these numbers are fairly close. They don't take into account hull design, but for one of these or any of these boats to say that they are a performance cruising boat, with the exception of the Katana in particular, it's just a little bit of a stretch, because all of these boats from the far left to the far right are going to perform reasonably well for the owner that is wanting to sail around the world. And that's the main takeaway from my perspective on the sail area displacement.
Okay. So now that we've talked about the two primary design ratios for sailing vessels, let's now talk about polars. The first thing I would have to say about polars is most manufacturers, when they publish their polars, those numbers are based on dry weight or pretty darn close to dry weight. And the reason for that is because they want their polars to just look awesome and to look better than the guy next door. But here's the reality. The reality is this, and we've sailed our boat now for 9 years, and we have polars for our boat. And what I will tell you is, and what most people know that are racers, every single boat that's built and comes off a line, each boat will have invariably a different polar, a slightly different polar. And a big reason for that is, what is the actual displacement of that boat when it splashes in the water? What is the actual displacement of that boat when it's really loaded up with all your gear, all your kit to go sailing? So you will find that even though you've got these, you know, fancy, you know, computer-generated polars to show you theoretically how will that boat perform in the best conditions, the flattest waters, etc., what's really important for a cruising boat, more than anything else, is how is your boat going to really perform when you're deeper into the wind. Sailing close wind on a catamaran, on any catamaran, is not as good, generally speaking, as sailing close to the wind on a monohull. But guess what? As a cruiser, I would say 80%+ of our time sailing on our boat for the past 8 years, 80% has been downwind, at least broad reaching and sometimes dead running. So for me and for us on our boat, what is most important on our polars is how well can we sail in light winds with low apparent wind? How well will our boat really perform against another boat that might be a heavier boat with less sail area, etc.? Those are important numbers for us. The question that is important for anybody to answer when you're buying a new boat is, what is fast enough? What is fast enough? What is comfortable enough? And what will you be happy with for doing your passage making? And what I can tell you from our viewpoint on field trip is this. It is very common for me to have Sarah say, "Hey Mark, can you slow down a bit? Can you put a reef in?" Because in her view, sailing comfortably is sailing safely, and sailing safely is not sailing quickly. So we generally are very conservative on how we sail. We reef a lot more than I normally would if I was sailing with a bunch of guys on board. And we find that is still very comfortable, and we can easily make, on a passage, 6.5, 7 knots sailing conservatively. Most other Antares owners are in the 7 to 8 knot range. And that's great. I mean, I think that if you look at the 7 to 8 knots on average on a passage, that puts you at 170 to just over to 200, 210 nautical miles a day. And those are good numbers. Do you want to be faster than that? We don't particularly care to be. We think that we can sail fast enough. In fact, we find ourselves dialing down the boat so we're not sailing too fast to keep everybody on board comfortable, safe, and happy. And that I can tell you, in a lot of cases, will be a lot more important than some polar that you are trying to push the limit to achieve another knot or two in speed. So what I would like to do at this point is to introduce a couple different Antares owners and get their perspective on some of their experiences in sailing the Antares. One of them in particular is going to talk about crossing the South Pacific
with the World Ark and just how did their boat stack up in performance to the other boats. We've got Russ also talking about his perspective as a racer from Sydney, Australia, on sailing his Antares, which he's owned for 10 years, about performance. And it'll be good to get their different perspectives and share them with you.
My name's Russ from Australia. I've owned Catamaran Salon and Antares 44 since 2010. Prior to this, I raced boats of all shapes and sizes over a 25-year period, including such blue water classics as the Sydney to Hobart Yacht Race. When I was asked about the Antares performance, I immediately said, look, it's an outstanding performer in terms of what it's been designed to do, which is a robust sailing mobile home. And there's no way I'd want to go cruising the world on any of the other boats that I've sailed over the years. But if you want to trade off certain specs in a boat's configuration to achieve greater speed, then it's possible. But then you'll be buying a different boat, and in the process, perhaps unwittingly, giving up something that is even more important. I haven't sailed a boat that doesn't have strengths and weaknesses. So the important thing is to understand fully the intended use, the where, the when, the how, and by whom. And the larger a vessel, the less manageable for a shorthanded crew. Really, how much space does a couple need? The only time we use all the areas on Salon is when we have guests aboard. I want to debunk this notion that people tout about of outrunning bad weather, like a high performance boat will always be fast enough. My experience when things get hairy is you don't want speed, you want seaworthiness. Typically a sailor has to integrate many inputs and then try and resolve the best plan possible under the circumstances. So my response to the outrun bad weather brigade is a fast boat won't save a poor captain, but a seaworthy one certainly forgives many errors of judgment. Wrapping up, as an experienced racing sailor, I'd say I decided my sail cruising home needed to be much more than a plastic rocket ship. So I happily traded away a certain amount of speed for what I judged were huge gains in seaworthiness and manageability, as I understood I'd be sailing shorthanded 24/7 far away from base, where ultimate speed was not the prime consideration.
When I was racing monohulls, a fast boat was a compilation of two factors. 60% of the time, the boat races hard to the wind, and 40% of the time, it's sailing in a direction that is dead downwind. A fast boat depends on what you're going to use it for. For example, 90% of the time when we sailed across the Pacific, the wind was from a beam or farther aft. Much of the time, we were sailing with large angles to the wind. That means you want a boat that performs well with the spinnaker up. And the Pacific typically has light air, so you want a boat that does well in light air. Contrast that with sailing in the Caribbean, where most of the time we encountered breezes that were 60% off of head to wind. And the breezes typically were 20 knots or greater. In that kind of scenario, you want a different type of performance. Oh, and by the way, sailing in the Caribbean often are very short island hops. So speed really doesn't make as much difference. It only means you're going to arrive at 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock, as opposed to the Pacific, it can make a difference of multiple days. Bigger is more bucks, and bigger or much higher loaded sails, which makes it difficult for a shorthanded crew to take a sail down when there's a problem. One of the keys to speed is not just the boat, it's also the captain. And in that aspect, when we were racing, we called it changing gears. And a classic changing gears thing on a racing monohull is to apply more backstay to extend a sail plan to a higher wind speed. Those tricks and tips are similarly possible on a cruising catamaran. For example, as the breeze rises, moving the jib car leads forward, twist the sails off and allows you to keep up the same sail area without reefing. Effectively, it gives you a gear between first gear and second gear. This is quite important because I don't agree with the mantra, reef the moment the thought strikes your mind. And the reason is you end up spending a lot of time in second gear when you should be going faster. Now, it's a conservative approach, but it's conservative with a penalty. And I think you can achieve the same benefits of reefing early if actually you just depower your boat in incremental steps. Now, when we look into how fast does your boat go, that's not the right question. The right question is, how fast does your boat go within the constraints of the way you wish to sail it? For example, when the boat's going 8 knots and the seas are quite large, that might be the extent of the speed you want to go. If you go to 12 knots, if you go to 10 knots, you might find that the sea state makes it very uncomfortable on board. At 8 knots, with slightly less sail area up, you find that you can still cook dinner, you can still watch movies, still enjoy yourself. In some sea states, 10, 11 knots becomes quite uncomfortable. And so even though the boat is quite willing to go faster, you choose to slow her down to respect the fact that you're cruising and you want to be comfortable. Now, it's nice to have a boat that can go fast when you're in flat water ripping down the Chesapeake in 30 knots. That's a great thing. But you also find that the polars aren't really your speeds because you're going to choose the speed that fits within your comfort requirements. When we talk about a fast boat, in order to unlock its speed, you have to have a sail plan set up to be able to trim the sails properly. And sometimes I've seen sailboats, catamarans, that don't have a vang. And I understand why they don't have a vang. It's one more system. In case of an extreme puff, the boom will lift up, and that's a safety feature. However, if you're really interested in performance, you need to have a vang. The vang is the key in a catamaran to ensure that you have the right amount of leech tension. If the hulls are very far apart, you'll get a bigger salon. But at the same time, it allows a bigger space for waves to develop between the two hulls. And as those waves develop, they hit the bridge deck, the area underneath the salon. And that slows the boat down a lot and is very uncomfortable. The Antares, for her size, is relatively narrow, thus avoiding a lot of bridge deck slap. Less hull in the water is less drag. This is very important for light air performance. In heavier airs, much of the hull drag goes away because of the large amount of pressure on the sails. But in light air, Antares typically benefits from having a much narrower hull. So, if you're looking at a boat that has an island berth in the hull, the cost will be you'll be dragging a lot more fiberglass through the water in light air and may need to turn your engine on earlier. Let me boast a bit about some of the actual data of performance. So the best 12-hour record is we maintained a speed of 11.2 knots as we were transiting the equator. So we were off the coast of Brazil, and we had breezes that were from the low 20 knots to 30 as squalls rolled through, and we were switching from the Genoa to the Screecher back and forth, and we were able to reach 11.2 knots average speed over 12 hours. We also reached 230 nautical miles was our record for one day, and had several days where we did over 200 nautical miles. Other comparisons is when we did the World Arc and during the Pacific Crossing, we frequently saw the Antares do well versus other boats. And specifically, the area that surprised me were some of the famous British and French monohulls. And what occurred is as they went downwind, they were very heavy because they were full of all the wonderful cruising amenities, but they were very difficult time with the low apparent wind to get the boat moving. And so typically, if the breeze was less than 13 knots or so, they had their engine on. And it made me wonder that for a Pacific crossing, you need to have a boat which has easily accessible downwind sails. I would say even maybe two spinnakers if you're very into sailing, but at least one for sure, and the screecher. And don't forget that a zigzag downwind is much faster than going straight downwind. Now, sometimes you'll go straight downwind because the waves are that direction and it's very comfortable, but you know you're going slower than the other choice of the zigzag. Now, there's a terminology called a performance cat that tries to distinguish itself from a cruising catamaran. And I think there's some prime examples out there which are performance cats, and they are wonderful boats. However, I think there's also a variety of boats that try to put the word performance in front of a cruising cat. If you're the same distance and you have the same amount of cruising gear on it, you're likely going to have similar performance. You just can't get away from waterline and weight being a big driver of performance.
Let's just tie this all together, and we've heard different perspectives from different people about performance. The question is, does performance matter? And the answer is absolutely yes. Unequivocally, I prefer to have a boat that I can still dial up my performance and sail comfortably and sail quickly, but I don't need to be the fastest boat on the water either. If you think about summarizing performance to me would be able to comfortably sail 7.5 to 8 knots on my boat with my family and have everybody happy versus sailing 9 or 10 knots screaming through the water and having a lot of tension between crew and family. So in summary, the Antares is designed to be a quick cruising catamaran, balancing safety and comfort. It's you can't have all of those all the time, but we believe, and the owners of Antares believe, that the design has met all their needs to be able to sail quickly, comfortably, and safely around the world. So end of the day, that is why all of these things fit together like a jigsaw puzzle on how this boat was designed, from the hulls to the interior being lightweight to the sail plan, to make this a very well-performing boat that is luxurious, comfortable, and safe. That is why the Antares is the world's best liveaboard.